it takes a lot of courage, one would assume, Mr. Bush, to once again accept our interview on a media based in Beijing, particularly when it comes to China-US relations, because I saw quite a number of people want to shy away from that topic, which they used to be very enthusiastic about.
Yeah. I don't know that the word courage fits here. I mean, it probably would be more courageous if a politician seeking office were to speak out and tell the truth about this important relationship. They might backfire on them because there's it's a political hot potato right now.
How do you feel about the atmosphere inside your country about China-US relations? What is the temperature right now?
Yeah, it's pretty obvious to me. And again, I'm not a politician and I'm not an analyst, but pretty obvious to me as an observer that the feelings towards China among the political elite, especially, have become very toxic, and it's discouraging to me, frankly. I mean, if people were, you know, fact driven and in their understanding of China, then there would be a lot less of this toxicity. But it's very sad to me to see, you know, that China's like a Mexican piñata. You know, it's the easiest thing in the world to bash on. And I can't wait. And I'm hopeful that this new administration, you know, will move in the direction of at least establishing more regular dialogue, which leads inevitably to better understanding and a lowering of tensions. And so far, they're off to a much better start than the past administration, in my opinion. So we'll see where it goes from here. My greatest hope is that, again, through closer contact and dialogue, that eventually, you know, we're going to see the political elite move to understanding that this relationship has been critically important over the past 30 years for our economic development in the United States.
Right.
It's helped to lift people out of poverty in China. And so there's been a tremendous bilateral benefit to our relationship, and that with the world as close as it is today, as connected as we are, that it would be a travesty to decouple or to enter into some kind of a Cold War phase. Yeah, it just seems crazy to enter into a phase of a Cold War. It doesn't make any sense. You know, if you think about this simple statistic, there are, in 2019, there were 169 million outbound flights by Chinese. 169 million. How can you have a Cold War where that many people are leaving and coming back to China all the time? You know, how can you have a Cold War where our economies are so deeply intertwined, and for the trade war to have started under the last administration? It was crazy. I'm optimistic that things are moving in the right direction, but I do fear that if somebody like Pompeo or, you know, this crazy guy like Cruz or some China hater gets to be president, then, you know, who knows where this is going to go.
So it's a genuine worry and concern here where I am in China, that no matter how much China showed gestures and made progress, it's not likely to change the political rhetorics inside Washington, because they're going to continue to use that, and they need that for either their district elections or the midterm or eventually another presidential election.
Yeah. No, I can imagine them being discouraged, but, you know, there had been so much interaction and so much connectivity between China and the United States, between Chinese students, for example, who have come to America and returned to China. Some have stayed. You know, you get to see these individuals as humans that are, you know, like me, like you, like us, being kind and generous towards others and that kind of thing. I'm hoping that the political incentive or motivation will be dampened by the reality that this connectivity between China and the United States has you know, benefits all of us, and that there's not a threat, that we're not, you know, explicitly being threatened by China.